friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 8th November 2018. The topics we'll be covering for prelims are these 7 items. The first one talks about International Telecommunication Union, which is a specialized body of United Nations. Second article talks about Ganga Gram Project. Third one talks about geographical indicators. Fourth one talks about Greater Nagaland, which worries Manipur. Fifth one is about the Vikram Samvat year. And sixth one talks about ECBs, that is external commercial borrowing. And the last article talks about China's new space station. The first article we'll be seeing is about International Telecommunication Union. This is taken from PIB. So the news here is that India has been elected as the member of United Nations International Telecommunication Union Council for a 4-year term. So this 4-year term, it extends from 2019 till 2022. So, International Telecommunication Union, as I said before, is a specialized agency under United Nations. This was established in the year 1865 and it was one of the earliest organizations established under the ambit of United Nations. And its main area of concern is with respect to areas concerning information as well as communication technology. This ITU, it works under PPP model. So it has both government agencies as well as the private sectors. Currently, there are 193 countries as well as 800 private sector entities, which includes even academic institutions. So this ITC is placed in Geneva, Switzerland, and this ITU is responsible for allocating global radio spectrum as well as satellite orbits for different countries. International Telecommunication Union, it also develops technical standards and ensures that the different networks as well as the technologies are interconnected, thereby providing a seamless digital connectivity to different countries of the world. And one of the important aims of International Telecommunication Union, especially in 21st century, is that it aims to connect the underserved communities worldwide. That is, it aims to provide digital connectivity and thereby providing digital inclusion to various communities of the developing countries. So with respect to India and ITU relationship, India has been a very active member of ITU since 1869. It has been eagerly supporting as well as promoting the digital connectivity among the global community of nations. So this positive relationship India has with ITU is represented in the form of the recently set up ITU South Asia Area Office and Technology Innovation Center in New Delhi. So this innovation center is located in New Delhi and it is a single center for whole South Asia area. And another important area one needs to cover for prelims is different index which is published by various global organizations. So here with respect to ITU, ITU publishes an index called as Global Cyber Security Index. So the second edition of Global Cyber Security Index was published in the year 2017. And this index, it ranks the countries worldwide depending upon the individual country's national policy against cybercrime. So thereby, by rating countries, it ensures that cybersecurity is inculcated within each country's policy making. In the 2017 ranking, India has been ranked at 23rd position under the category of maturing nations. This index is calculated based on 5 categories. Number 1 is national efforts in legal measures, technical measures, organizational measures, capacity building of each country, as well as cooperation between the different countries. The second article we'll be seeing is about pilot Ganga Grams. So this article was also taken from PIB. So this Ganga Gram project was initiated by Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. It was a project which was inaugurated in the year 2017 in order to transform the villages over the bank of river Ganga into ideal villages. So totally there are 5 states which are covered under this Ganga Gram project. That is the 5 states which are located in the banks of river Ganga. And there are totally about 4,500 Ganga bank villages in this project. So the main aim of this project is to make all these villages open defecation free, and this status has been achieved by this project currently. And now major efforts has been ramped up by Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation in the direction of sustaining the open defecation free status provided under this Yojana. So we'll see what are the main components of this Ganga Gram project. Okay, the Ganga Gram project consists of totally 8 important points which needs to be covered. And the first point is making all the villages across the river Ganga open defecation free. And this also has major links with Swachh Bharat scheme of India. And the second is the proper management of village waste draining into River Ganga. So this village waste draining has been major source of water pollution of River Ganga. The third is ensuring proper disposal of solid waste. The solid waste is not just let by the households, it is also let out into clear River Ganga by industries located in the banks of River Ganga as well. The fourth one is to ensure water conservation activities by water harvesting, groundwater recharge mechanism, as well as building ponds and promotion of sprinkler irrigation. So that is, it even takes into consideration micro irrigation technologies to save water. The fifth aim is to encourage plantation of medicinal plants and promotion of organic farming, thereby conserving the environment. The sixth one is the construction of crematorium. This is because India is a very diverse country and many religions in India, they have the practice of disposing the dead into the water bodies of India. And this has been a major source of pollution, especially to River Ganga. And construction of crematorium has been aimed to correct this practice in India. The seventh one is promotion of tourism. Having clean Ganga as well as clean Ganga grams will definitely attract more tourism, which will directly and indirectly create more jobs. And the last measure under the Ganga Gram project is coordination between various central as well as state run schemes and their implementation on the Ganga Gram. So coordination between various central as well as the state schemes is very much essential in order to bring in inclusive change as well as to conserve the economic resources allocated to different schemes. So this program aims to bring a comprehensive development of the villages, thereby improving their economic, historic, cultural as well as social friends, thereby bringing in a sustainable change. This infographic shows the Ganga Basin in India. The Ganga Basin, it basically comprises of 11 states as it has 17 major tributaries including Yamuna, Kosi and Chambal. And this program Ganga Gram is covered under 5 states: Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand as well as West Bengal. As this infographic states, about 500 million people live in Ganga Basin area. So this shows the importance in the reach of this project. And 25% of India's water resources are accounted for by this river Ganga alone. There are 50 major cities which are located in the banks of River Ganga, and there are more than 50,000 population, they live in the banks of River Ganga. So this even increases the reach of the program. And River Ganga alone, according to the World Bank estimate, it contributes about $700 billion to the GDP, and 200 million people, they live below poverty line in the Ganga Basin area. Apart from social front, Ganga is also ecologically very diverse area. It consists of 140 fish species. Two major biosphere reserves, namely Nanda Devi and Sundarbans, are located in the banks of River Ganga. And it also houses few world's most endangered species, including gangetic dolphin, as well as Royal Bengal tiger, which is located in the Sundarbans. All the social, economical and cultural dimensions show the importance of this project and bringing in a sustainable change in the people living in this area. And bringing in sustainable change in the Ganga River Basin. The third article we'll be seeing is with respect to geographical indications. This article was taken from Hindu. The geographical indications was in use because Erode turmeric, a turmeric variety with high medicinal value, has been given geographical indication in India. So what is geographical indicator? So the geographical indicator tag or the GI tag is a name or a sign which is used on certain products corresponding to certain geographical location. So by specifying the geographical location, one can find the origin of the product. So this GI tag can be given for agricultural products, natural products, and even manufactured products which have certain distinctive traits attached to its origin. So this GI indication, it comes under trade related aspects of intellectual property, that is TRIPS agreement of WTO. The articles 22 to 24 of this TRIPS agreement, it specifically talks about the geographical indicator. So in India, the geographical indicator is regulated by a specific act called as Geographical Indicator of Goods Registration and Protection Act of 1999. However, this act came into force only in the year 2003. In India, this act comes under the administration of a specific body called as Controller General of Patents, Designs and Trademarks, who is also the Register of Geographical Indicators in India. So in India, this GI tag is given for a period of 10 years, after which the GI tag needs to be renewed. By giving a product a GI tag, it ensures the authenticity of the product, which in turn will give the product a reputation in the global market. So there are three main ways to protect the geographical indication. Number one is via sui generis system, that is special regimes for protection of GI tag alone. Number two is by using collective or certification marks. And the third is by focusing on business practices, including administrative approvals and schemes for related to GI. This infographic, it talks about the various geographical indicators in India. India is a very diverse country and each state is associated with certain distinctive product. For example, state of Tamil Nadu is known for Kanchiwaram silks and Tanjavur paintings, whereas the state of West Bengal is known for Darjeeling tea and Rasgulla. If you go to northeast, in Mizoram, Mizo chili has been given a geographical indicator, and in Meghalaya, Khasi mandarin is a geographical indicator. In western part of India, in Rajasthan, blue pottery of Jaipur, Kolhapuris of Rajasthan, Bikaner Bhujia has been given geographical indicator, and in Gujarat, Kesar mango, Kutch embroidery has been given geographical indicator. The fourth article we'll be seeing is Greater Nagaland Idea Worries Manipur. This article was also taken from the newspaper Hindu. So recently, a civilian rally was conducted in the state of Manipur in northeast against the inclusion of parts of Manipur into the Greater Nagaland. So we all know Manipur and Nagaland are adjacent states. Nagaland is located here and Manipur is located just below it. And there is a concept called as Greater Nagaland. And under Greater Nagaland, all contiguous Naga inhabited areas, that is the areas where Naga tribal people are inhabited, are included under a concept of Greater Nagaland. And this Greater Nagaland includes several districts of Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, and even part of Myanmar. This has led to recent tensions in the state of Manipur. The ethnic Manipuris in the state of Manipur are seeing this as a threat to territorial integrity, and they call for preservation of their territorial integrity here. The fifth article we'll be seeing is with respect to Vikram Samvat. So this article was also taken from Hindu. So the article was based on economics news, but what we have to know for the prelims is regarding Vikram Samvat year. So the year, the Vikram Samvat is often associated with Raja Vikramaditya of Ujjain. So it is believed that this calendar, it marks the victory of Raja Vikramaditya over Saka in the year 57 BC. And in North India, this calendar begins with the beginning of Chaitra month, whereas in Gujarat, it begins with the beginning of Kartika. And in some other parts of Gujarat, the year begins with Amavasya of Ashada month. The next article we'll be seeing is with respect to external commercial borrowing. This article was also taken from the paper Hindu. So for the prelims, one has to know what ECB is. So ECB is a financial instrument. So it is basically used to borrow money from the foreign countries. So by borrowing money from the external sources, this external commercial borrowing is used as a financial instrument to invest in commercial activities in the domestic country, that is India here. So this ECB can be any of these forms, for example, commercial bank loans. One can also get securitized instruments such as floating rate notes as fixed rate bonds, or it can even be in the form of credit from official export credit agencies. Or even ECB can consist of commercial borrowings from multilateral financial institutions like IMF. So what are the advantages of having this financial instrument ECB? So ECBs, it provide an opportunity to borrow a large volume of money at one go. So by borrowing large amount of money, it contributes to larger investment, thereby bringing in economic growth. Second advantage is the funds via ECBs are available for relatively long term, and the interest rates are also lower when compared to other domestic borrowings. So these are the advantages due to which many investors go for external commercial borrowings over other domestic sources of borrowing. The final article for prelims we'll be seeing is China Space Station. So this article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So we all know about ISS, that is International Space Station. So this International Space Station is a collaboration between various countries like US, Russia, Canada, Europe, as well as Japan. So this ISS has been in operation since the year 1998, and it is expected to be retired by the year 2024. Because of its retirement, China is building a new space station for itself. So this space station is called as Tiangong 2, and this is the first permanently crewed space station of China, and it is expected to contain 3-member crew in space. And various microgravity research in addition to the already conducted space observation. So this Tiangong 2 is a successor to Tiangong 1. It was launched in the year 2011 and it is renewed to be continued till the year 2018. The topics for mains are BS6, that is Bharat Stage 6 emission norms in India, and the shape of sanctions, which deals with Iran-US relationship and its effect on India. The first article for mains we'll be seeing is Advancing BS6 Emission Norms. So what is this BS6? So this BS6 is Bharat Stage 6 standards, and this Bharat Stage 6 standards is in par with Euro standards. And these are basically the technology which needs to be harnessed in order to reduce the pollution level significantly. The Supreme Court of India gave an order on October 24, thereby banning the sale and registration of the vehicles conforming to Bharat Stage 4 across India from 2020 April. This is mainly to control the alarming pollution which has been experienced by major cities in India. Here we need to know a bit more history about Bharat Stage standard. So the Bharat Stage 1, which is parallel to Euro Stage 1 norms, it came into force in the year 1991 in India for petrol vehicles and in the year 1992 for diesel vehicles in India. However, it was only in the year 2000, both commercial as well as the passenger vehicles, they adopted Bharat Stage 1 standards. And Bharat Stage 2 standards, it came into force in 2001. And Bharat Stage 4, it came into force in the year 2017. So as against the earlier roadmap, which was laid by the government stating the adoption of Bharat Stage 5 by the year 2020, the government, in order to curtail the alarming level of pollution, especially in Delhi NCR region, it decided to skip Bharat Stage 5 standards altogether and going for the introduction of Bharat Stage 6 standards from the year 2020. This Bharat Stage 6, it contains a special type of technology called as Selective Catalytic Emission Reduction Technology. Via the Selective Catalytic Emission Technology, the level of nitrogen oxides will significantly come down, which will in turn reduce the pollution level in the atmosphere. However, adopting this technology requires significant change to be made by the manufacturers of the automobile industry. This will in turn make the cost of the vehicles rise, and thus the vehicles will be more expensive now. The final article we'll be seeing is Shape of Sanctions on US Waiver on Chabahar Port. This article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So recently, the US administration has decided to grant India and 7 other countries waivers on sanctions that it reimposed on Iran, thus providing a temporary relief to India. So this decision of US administration will have significant effects on India. So India, as we all know, India has invested in Iran's Chabahar port, and this Chabahar port is aimed to increase the connectivity of India with Afghanistan as well as Central Asian nations. India is also planning to build a railway line connecting Chabahar to Afghanistan, thus bypassing Pakistan altogether. As I said before, the waivers of USA for India are temporary, and this will definitely have certain manifestations on India. The first effect it will have is on the oil trade India has with Iran. So India is now forced to a situation to find alternatives in order to avoid the trade of oil which it has with Iran. So according to the current statistics, India nearly buys 10% of its oil requirements from Iran, and it stands third just after Saudi Arabia and Iraq. The second important point is European Union, Russia as well as China, they are working towards something called a special payment mechanism. This special payment mechanism is aimed to circumvent the sanctions imposed by US on Iran. However, this plan is not yet launched and India cannot find any recourse via this mechanism against the sanctions imposed by US. The third dimension is with respect to investment made by India in the Chabahar port. So, the sanctions imposed by USA is not just on the US government, but as well as also on the business sector. So, in order to develop the Chabahar port, India requires to sign contracts with various international companies. There are very few international companies willing to undertake the contracts because of the fear of US sanctions. So, this is another issue India needs to face. The fourth dimension is with respect to CAATSA, that is Countering Adversaries of America Through Sanctions Act. So, via this act, if any country has trade relationship with North Korea, Iran or Russia, they are bound to attract sanctions from United States under this act. India also needs to get waiver in order to avoid these sanctions. So, unlike China, which has decided to go forward and carry on trade with Iran regardless of the US sanctions, India has now entered into the table of negotiation in order to find other alternative fuel supplies from other countries in the Gulf area. This will definitely have effect on India-Iran long-term relationship. So, thus the foreign policy of India must be from the perspective of India rather than based on any other alien country, which is US here. Thank you.